If you've come tonight ready to bless that wonderful name of Jesus, I invite you to stand up on your feet and begin to worship with us. If you have a need in the house, can you represent that with uplifted hands, whether it's a spoken request or an unspoken request? Let's take those before the Lord right now. Dear God, we're so thankful for this opportunity to be here tonight and to be in your presence, Lord. To be here gathered together to worship your name, Lord God. We bring to you every need before you tonight, Lord. Every need of healing, every need of restoration, every need of deliverance, Lord God. We believe in you and in your healing power, Lord Jesus. Everything that we ask in your name, God, you are more than capable. You are more than able, God. We trust and we believe in your powerful name, in that wonderful name, in that healing and saving name of Jesus. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. I would ask the ushers to come at this time to prepare to take up our offering. You may be seated if you'd like to. Please remember that we do have 6 young people at camp this week. Be praying for them, praying for a mighty move of the Lord in their lives, and that they come back riled up in the spirit, though.
Yes.
Riled up in the spirit, right? Hopefully we tame a little bit of the extra stuff while we're there. I don't know. Malachi needs it. Jesus' name. I I apologize. I didn't bring a bulletin up here in front of me, so I'm not sure exactly what is going on this week, but do make sure to check the announcements that are going on in the foyer before you leave. Also, please remember our Sunday school service this Sunday at 10 a.m. Then our family worship will begin at 11 a.m. Invite somebody. Come yourselves. We're excited about this new summer schedule and just the opportunity that it affords some of the under ministries to just start other activities and things like that and see how it goes. Are you ready to give? Are you cheerful about it? Because even though I don't have a scripture to put up there to show you guys, I think we all know that it says the Lord loves a cheerful giver. Let's pray for our offering this evening. Dear God, we're so thankful for this opportunity to come tonight and to give into your kingdom. God, I ask that you would bless each gift, that you would bless each giver, and that it would go to the furtherance of your kingdom. In your mighty name, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Because of who you are. Let's sing it together. Clap your hands and thank Him for it this evening. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, everybody say praise the Lord. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. Praise God. Amen. There's nobody like the Lord. We have ever needed anything in our life, it is Jesus Christ. Amen. And we just have to be determined that no matter what comes our way, amen, we need to be determined that we're going to succeed in Him. Amen. Praise God. Remember all those still that are sick. And struggling with the weather. I was talking to somebody today. They were struggling a little bit and said it's a camp. It's a camp thing. They were at camp all last week. And all that lake air and that temperature, heat, and all that kind of got to them. Proverbs, the third chapter this evening, I got a couple verses that I want to deal with tonight. So you bear with me and we'll, amen, get through this. Thank you for your worship. There's nothing like pure worship from a sincere heart that actually it means something to God. I think a lot of people sing, but it really just that's all they're doing. But when you put your heart with it, amen, God receives that. He inhabits those praises. Proverbs, the third chapter, verses 5 and 6 this evening. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm glad to see you here tonight. And I want us to read these two verses out loud together. Let's begin. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct thy paths. The translation says He will direct, or He will make smooth our paths. Amen. I'm happy for that tonight. How many's ever walked on gravel barefooted? Have you ever done that before? You don't smoothly walk on that. You know, you're going like this. Right? It hurts. But if you have smooth ground, I'm glad that God can direct our paths or smooth our ground that we're walking on. Amen. That's why serving Him means so much, right? Lord God, we thank You once again for Your presence that we feel in this place tonight. For the next little bit, Lord God, I pray, Lord, that Your word would have an impact in our heart and our lives, that it will give us that direction that we need, that it help us along the way, everything we face, circumstances, whatever they might be. Amen. Our faith, our hope, our trust is in You, and everybody say in Jesus' name. Praise God. Well, you may be seated. And somebody showed me some pictures a little while ago of James. That Susong or comes with, he's the son. Had him praying and in the altar last night at camp, and that's a pretty exciting picture when you see your kids. And hey, amen. I was talking to before service that how youth camps, hey, amen, is a little different than a regular church service because you got about 200 or 300 kids, and they all kind of go to the altar together. You know how it is sometimes. the altar. We just kind of shy away from it. But they all go to that altar. And in the midst of that, amen, kids that maybe normally just didn't tap into the Spirit of God, all of a sudden they find themselves in the midst of something that, amen, they may have not felt in that way. And next thing you know, they got their hands up and they're crying and praying and, amen, receiving the Spirit of God. And that's what's important. So youth camps are important. Amen. They are, and we're glad for them. Everybody say, in God we trust. Do you know that phrase? Where do you see that phrase? On money. Everybody say money. We all like money, right? Amen. So let me say it this way. In God we trust. Or do we? In God we trust, or do we? Do we really trust in Him? Is our faith in Him? Do we take His word as gospel? Amen. Amen. Do we believe in His word? Does His word challenge us? Do we receive it? So in God we trust. You know the motto, you've heard this probably before, but it was placed on United States coins largely because of the increased religious sentiment existing during the Civil War. And it was at that time that Secretary of Treasury Salmon P. Chase received many appeals from devout folks throughout the country, urging that the United States recognize the deity on United States coins. Recognize it. People were inspired. People believed. People had a relationship with God. Because of that, Secretary Chase instructed James Pollock, who was the director of the Mint at Philadelphia. He directed him to prepare a motto in a letter that was dated November the 20th, 1861. And here's what it said. Dear sir, no nation can be strong except in the strength of God, or safe except in His defense. The trust of our people in God should be declared on our national coins. You will cause a device to be prepared without unnecessary delay, with a motto expressing in the fewest and tersest words possible the national recognition. The national recognition. In God we trust. We live in a day now to where they're trying to get God out of everything and God off of everything. Those words don't mean the same that they used to. There's no real spirituality to that. Back then there was a spiritual sense about it. We want people to know, so we want it inscribed on our coins. In God we trust. Think about that. So since 1938, all United States coins bear that inscription, in God we trust. Then there was a law passed in the 84th Congress, and it was approved by the president on July the 11th, 1955, that said that the motto should appear on all United States paper currency and coins. Now let me read you again Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6 in a translation that says it like this. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. All. It's like that song we sing that says, He wants all of our heart. Not just a part, not a segment of your life or a segment of your heart or a piece of it. No, all of your heart. If you serve the Lord with all of your heart, mind, soul, strength, that's what resonates with God. That's what gets you where you need to be with God. So trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Notice what it says. Never relying on what you think or what you know. It is that process that will interfere in the process of trusting Him with all of our heart. When you begin to rely on your knowledge, on your thoughts, on your ways, let me say it again, it will interfere in giving God all of your heart. So never rely on what you think you know. Why? Remember the Lord in everything you do, and He will show you the right way. Remember the Lord in all you do, and He will direct your paths. See, that's our problem today, I believe, is the fact that we lack the wisdom that we really need in this day and time to survive spiritually. Because in our world today, if you listen closely, you'll find out that a lot of people don't want anything to do with God. They want a separation to where Christianity is no longer in the forefront of our nation. Amen. Bury it somewhere. Leave it alone. We don't want God. We don't want anything to do with God. We don't think it needs to be a part of who we are. But we started with God. And all I'm saying, wisdom says, if you start with God and you maintain that relationship with God, and you talk to God, and you will, begin to engage in your relationship with God, that's when He is able to direct you. But it's when you decide you don't need God. Look, let me say it this way. Our nation is in big trouble right now. You know why? Because God is not at the forefront of our minds. When a congressman will say, bluntly, when somebody in Congress is talking about God, and they speak up and say, God has no place in Congress. Now, I don't know what that does to you, but to me, that alarms me. Because if your leadership in your country does not respect God or does not want God to be in the forefront of our mind, then we have no other place to go but down. Wisdom says, rely not on your own knowledge, but on your relationship with God. Lean, trust in the Lord with all. Never rely on what you think or what you know. But remember God in everything you do, and He will direct or show you the right way. So today, I want to look at these verses a little bit. Won't be long today, I promise you, because I'm only looking at a couple verses from this book of Proverbs that teaches us a couple things. When and how. Everybody say when and how. And really, honestly, we could say that, there are more, but I can safely say that there are three times in life when you and I should trust in God. Now, it doesn't sound like a lot, right? But there are at least three. So let's look at these. Number one, what did he say? He said, put your trust in God. Put your trust in God. In fact, verse 5, let me read it again, says, trust the Lord with all your heart. Lean not your own understanding. In other words, when things happen that you just don't understand, why? I don't understand that. Has anybody asked God that? I think probably all of us have. Why? I don't understand, God. It doesn't make sense to my mind. I don't understand this. This is going on in my life. Hey man, there's something happening right now, and I just don't get it. I go back here to Genesis 12. Just kind of follow with me tonight a little bit here. Genesis 12. Here is Abraham, and here in Genesis 12, Abraham is really a poor example of relying on God. Because it's here in the 12th chapter, you see the call of Abram, and he's called out, and then you get over to the 10th verse where they were driven into Egypt because of famine. Verse 10 says, and there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down into Egypt to sojourn there, for the famine was grievous in the land. Now, I'm going to throw something spiritually at you right now. This was a physical thing that was going on. But I believe in our day and time, there's another famine that's here. But the famine that we're dealing with is an eternal thing. It's going to affect your eternal life. We have a famine or a lack of our trust in God. We have a lack of a spiritual famine going on in our world today. Right? And it came to pass when he was come near into Egypt and said unto Sarai, his wife, behold now, I know that thou art a fair woman to look upon. That word fair there says beautiful. Everybody say beautiful. Therefore it shall come to pass when the Egyptians shall see thee, that they shall say, this is his wife. And they'll kill me, but they will spare you. They will save you alive. Say, I pray thee, thou art my sister, that it may be well with me for thy sake, and my soul shall live because of thee. So what happened here? Abraham was depending on his own knowledge, his own word, his own way. Fear got a hold of him. Amen. He forgot to remember the Lord and trust. He was there for a reason. There was famine. There was food in Egypt. Hear me right now. There's famine in the world, but there's food in the church. You're not going to find it in the world. Let me say it this way. You know it. The world didn't give it to me. Amen. And the world can't take it away. We can give it away. Amen. But we're not going to get it taken away, right? Come on, somebody say praise the Lord. So he said, here, look, we're going to go here. You're a beautiful woman. And they're going to look at you and they're going to say, oh, she is his wife. So let's just kill him so we can have her. You go on down and you'll find out that she went with Pharaoh, right? All of a sudden, a bunch of plagues hit his house. Amen. God said, uh-uh. No, you can't touch this woman. Revealed to him what was going on. And so he goes back to Abraham and says, what have you done? Why have you passed her off and not told me that this is your wife? Now we're paying a price for your deception. You deceived me. Here, take your wife back. Get his men. Get these people and get them out of here. Listen, I don't care what's going on in your life. Your faith, your trust, your hope needs to continue to be in Christ Jesus. Because that's what's going to get you through the whys. That's what's going to get you through not understanding something in your life. Amen. Because the enemy's always going to try to play with that and play that up in your mind. But you have to say, you know what? Amen. It's not about what I think or what I know. It's the trust that I have in God. I'm going to rely on that because that's where he will direct my paths. He will lead me. He will guide me. What a truth here. See, things may happen in your life that you don't absolutely understand right now. That old song says, but we'll understand it better by and by. By and by when the morning comes, right? And all the saints of God are gathered home. I may not understand everything now, amen, but I'm not looking for the now. I'm looking for the then, when I get to see him face to face. No matter what I faced in this world, no matter what uncertainty, no matter what the problem is, amen, I'm living for that moment that I see Him face to face. Amen. Don't understand it. My own sense of understanding will not get me through life. It won't, because I'm not going to understand everything. Amen? I'm not going to understand it. But if I trust in God, when I don't understand it, that's what will get me through. Come on, everybody say, I'll understand it better by and by. I don't understand everything. I don't understand it. As a pastor, I go through things. I've went through things for almost 40 years, and in ministry almost 44 years. I've gone through things. I've seen sorrow. I've seen grief. I've seen heartache. I've seen people that just were beside themselves in grief, not knowing what to do, and not having answers. You understand me? Amen. Young, old, didn't matter. Babies. I even asked God, why? Why did this happen? Why? But there's one thing that I do understand that Abram has taught me is that just rely on God. Don't let deception become a part of your life. But rely on God, because that reliance is going to help you get through that situation or that problem. Not my own sense, not my own understanding, but my trust. Amen. So I've got to put my trust. Everybody say, put your trust in God. Put your trust in God, number one, when things happen that you just don't understand. Put your trust in God when you are faced, number two, when you are faced with a decision. Everybody say a decision. Let me go back here, verse 6. What's it say? In all thy ways acknowledge Him. In all thy ways acknowledge Him. There's a decision that has to be made. I have decided, the old song says, to follow Jesus. I've heard testimonies years ago. I can see her right now, especially in the old church. And her testimony was simply this. If none of my children live for God, and then she'd start. I've decided, me, I'm going to serve God. I don't want my family to be lost, but I have decided that I'm going to be saved. I have. I'm going to live for Jesus. I'm going to walk in His paths of righteousness for His name's sake. I'm going to serve Him. Turn to your neighbor and say, I'm going to serve Him. I'm going to serve Him. When I'm faced with a decision, I'm going to make that decision that I'm going to serve God. I'm going to live for God. I'm going to walk with God. I'm going to humble myself before God. Huh? And in all my ways, I'm going to acknowledge Him no matter what's going on in my life. Amen. So we all know it's a good idea to seek God's guidance, right? How many knows that to be true? Amen. When you're making major decisions in your life, now, folks, I'll put it to you this way. I don't care. Don't come and ask me what color you should paint your house. All right? Now, years ago, I knew people that would actually go ask their pastor what color they should paint their house. If they're going to paint their house blue, they would go ask, we want to paint our house blue. What do you think? Well, I'm of the persuasion, I don't care what you paint your house. I don't care what color you use in your bathroom or your kitchen. You know? If I don't like it, I ain't going to tell you. Right? It doesn't matter to me, Brother Howard. In fact, in my house, you know, if you come to my house, if my wife says, hey, I think I want to paint this such and such color, I'm going to say, whatever you think. It's okay with me. Men, do you know what I'm talking about? Yeah, if I want to do this or I want to do that, your safe answer is, hey, babe, whatever you want to do, that's fine with me. Right? That's your safe answer. Don't start thinking at that moment. Don't start thinking. Don't try to interject what you want. No, just stop for a moment and say, yeah, that's good. Thank you. Don't say something like, I'm going to like it whether I do or not. Right? No, understand that. Amen. We know it's good. It's a good idea to seek God, amen, in His guidance. Now, let me go this point. Now, there are times when you need to seek God. When you're making serious decisions in your life, things like a career change or moving or you know, getting married. Yeah. Getting married used to be something, it used to be a highlight in people's lives. Nowadays, it's like, you know, do we have to say till death do us part? You know, in sickness and in health, and good times and bad. Richer or poorer, we want the health, we want the richer. Nowadays, it doesn't mean anything to people. Hear them talk out there. They don't like that. In fact, we're not having a lot of kids in our nation now. And the problem of it is because a lot of people are getting to where they're just, you know, it's all about them. It's all about them. It's all about what they want, what they need. The problem of it is you're going to get to a certain age where that's over. Then what are you going to do? Hear me right now. Yeah, you need to talk to God when you're making some serious decisions in your life. You need to talk to God when you're going to marry, you know. You need to talk to God when you buy that house. Why? Because you just need to say, God, I want your will. Amen. Because, you know, you go buy a car, you just need to pray, God, I want to buy this car, but Lord, you know, I'm just praying. I'm just saying, God, help me. Help me with this decision. Right? Now, there are some things you can, in your own mind, you walk up that car and you see that sticker price and you know right then whether or not you can afford that car. That banker gets to you and says, oh, and starts working all the numbers and says, yeah, we can do this, 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 and this, and this, and this, and this, and this. And my wife says, no, that's not what I agreed to. Why is this in here? Oh, she'll frustrate those salespeople. Pretty soon they come and get the sales manager and he comes and it's like, it's all over. I'm just ready to go home. No. You got to be smart about things. But talk to God. Talk to God. Everybody say, talk to God. Amen. It's good to seek the Lord. But here, it's not just the big decisions that you need to trust God with. We need to turn to Him for guidance on any decision that we make. That's my thought. Take it for what it's worth. But I want to talk to God on all the decisions of my life. I want to kind of check it out with God. It's important. It's important. Our relationships are important. You know, our home life is important. Our work is important. Decisions that we make, they're important. Amen. So talk to the Lord and say, look, I'm not going to lean on my own understanding. Lord, I want your peace in my life. But once again, I think God could care less what you paint your house. Hallelujah. In all thy ways. Amen. Seek Him for guidance. He said, in all thy ways acknowledge Him. All thy ways acknowledge Him. The third thing here, put your trust in God. Number one, when things happen that you don't understand. Two, when you're faced with a decision. Three, trust in God when the future seems uncertain. Uncertain. Man, we live in uncertain times. But you know what? It helps me to trust in God in these uncertain times. Why? Because that's where my peace comes from. That's where my restfulness comes from. We live in a restless world, but my restfulness comes from God. I could lay my head on a pillow at night and be at peace. Why? Because He is the peace giver. I could lay my head down and not worry about what happens in the middle of the night because He is with me. Right? I don't have to wake up tomorrow morning and hear some news that might have happened around town or in the state or in the country or in the world. Amen. I can just say, God, I can look at it and say, wow, that was crazy. But God, You're still in control. Amen. In all thy ways acknowledge Him. In all thy ways. In all thy ways. Trust in Him when the future seems uncertain. Now, let me say something here. I told you I wasn't going to speak long tonight. But here's the deal. When you look at this verse isn't saying that He will make your life easy. How many would like your life to be easy? No, He's not saying, I'm going to make your life easy. He said, I'm going to make your life focused. It's my desire to live for Jesus, right? Above all else, I must be saved. No matter what's going on in my life, no matter what the insert, I have these goals that I'm going to stay true to Jesus Christ. Not my will, but His way. His will. Not my way, but His way. Amen. Why? Because I understand that He is focused on my life, and I'm going to acknowledge Him and seek Him for everything that I do. Right? Why? Because it says He will give you a direction. Right? He will be your GPS. Your GPS, right? Is that important? Oh, it is. It is. I was laughing today. I was talking to my daughter, and she was telling me she was leaving where she was working at. It was a new place because she was filling in for somebody while they're out. And so I'm like, where are you at? And she's like, I don't know. I'm just following my GPS. Right? How many have ever felt that way before? Right? So there's a lot of times I like my sense when I'm in my car. I want to know where I'm going. I want to know what direction it is. So if I get in a car that doesn't have a compass in it, I'm always looking for that S or SW or W or N for north, right? How many does that? Does anybody do that besides me? Amen. Why? Because I know the direction I'm supposed to be going. And if that ain't right, I know, okay, something's not right here. You see, that's the way it is with Jesus Christ. He will give you a direction in your life. Amen. You got to look to Him, amen, because He will point you in the right direction. It's when your eyes get off of Him. I have one on my phone. I can be up in the plane 32 plus thousand feet, and I can look at my phone, and that I've got a compass on my phone, big old thing, and it'll kind of point me, hey, you're going this direction, or you're going that direction, or whatever. Amen. It's just an app. You can put it on your phone. But I like that. I like to know, because I might know the direction I'm supposed to be going in my head, but sometimes you can get disoriented. And that's the way it is in our spiritual life sometimes. Sometimes we can be disoriented spiritually, and we need to look to Him because He will give us the direction, the pathway in which we are to go in, right? Do you thank God for that tonight? Right? Do you thank God that He is the direction in your life? He can point you that way? Amen. So He will give you direction, and He will also give you purpose. Purpose in life. What's that look like? Well, let me tell you. You will know where you're going and what you are doing. Wisdom. Wisdom is trusting in God. Not leaning on your own and relying on your own knowledge and your own understanding, but trusting in Him. Because He's not going to lead you astray. He's going to put you on the right path. Amen. Trusting God means that you don't have to try to make sense of all the areas of your life. You will drive yourself crazy if you try to make sense of everything in your life. Why? Because if you trust in Him, He will help you make sense of them. You can't do it in your own mind. You can't lean on your own understanding. So if you're not sure where you're going in life, if you're uncertain about the future, I would suggest tonight that you begin to trust in Him. Trust in Him. Lean on Him. Let me give you the third thing we're going to talk about. What does it mean to do that? What does it mean to trust in God? Well, let me give you a couple things, a couple words here. Trust and obedience, they go hand in hand. They go hand in hand. In fact, let's go back, if you will, to where you at, Isaiah. Let's go to Isaiah 64 and 6. You know, this is a prayer for help here, but listen to what he says here. But we are all as an unclean thing, and all your righteousness are as filthy rags, and we all do fade as a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind have taken us away. All of your righteousnesses are as filthy rags, or literally a filthy garment. A filthy garment. Are you comfortable with wearing filthy things? Huh? Do you know, if you wear the same thing over and over again, pretty soon you're going to stink. Right? There's a reason why you don't wear your socks over and over and over again. Because it's going to get pretty putrid. I remember as a kid growing up playing ball and all this kind of stuff, you know, man, your dad, you're good. And then you wouldn't pay attention, you'd take your tennis shoes off, next thing you know, go somewhere else, come back in, you know, what is that smell? How many knows what I'm talking about? Baby powder was the best thing, man. You take that baby powder, you stick it in there and run around. Think about it. You keep wearing the same stuff, you're going to stink. That's why you got to wash it. That's why every now and then your life, that's why you need to be in, you need to have that relationship with God. Why? You need Him to wash you and clean you up every now and then. Right? And so we have to realize that what does it mean to trust God? Trust and obedience. Understand that we are unclean and we need cleansing. Amen. We need God. Everybody say, I need God. Amen. I go over to Romans here real quick. Romans, the third chapter and verse 23. Here's what it says. For all, everybody say all, have sinned and come short, or you have fallen short of the glory of God. All, everybody say all. We need a divine provision in our life. We can exceed in our own standards, but never, if we're left to ourselves, if I am left to myself, I'm going to fail. I'm going to falter. I'm going to fall short of His glory. I'm not going to make it. So whatever it is that you trust today, God simply says this. Whatever you're doing, it doesn't measure up. Whatever you're trusting in today, none of them are worth staking your eternity on. Because if you trust in the world, look, I do this often, but if you read the end of the book, and if you read the Word of God, you understand, if I put my trust in this world, I'm not going to see the promises of God. If I put my trust in the world and I lean on the world, it's not going to last. But what will last is my trust in God. Because God said, the trust you have in the world, it doesn't measure up. You see, God knew that we did not and could not measure up to His standards. Couldn't. That's why He provided a substitute to pay. How many's glad for Calvary? How many's glad for Christ going to the cross and paying the price for our sin in spite of us? In spite of us. In spite of my ignorance. In spite of my lack of trust. In spite of leaning on my own understanding and my own knowledge. In spite of all of that, He said, you know what? You trust in me. Don't put yourself in that realm of trusting in this, because it'll falter, it'll fail. But my relationship will not. In spite, everybody say, in spite of me. Amen. Let me read a couple more scriptures here. Isaiah 53:6. Isaiah 53:6. Amen. This is talking about Jesus. All we like sheep have gone astray. Those words, all we, literally the translation is all of us. Everybody say that with me, all of us. All of us like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He took it for us. He's talking about Jesus. Let's go to John 14. John 14 and verse 6. Let me read this for you real quick. Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. He is the way. He's the truth. He's the life. Amen. He is the way. He's the way. He does not show. He does not tell them about the way. He does not even guide them along the way. He said, I am the way. I am the way. I'm the truth. So when it comes to living your life as you seek to get it together and keep it together, amen, you can follow one of two strategies. You can either wander around in the dark trying to figure it out on your own. How many's ever tried to do that before? You know what? It's almost like, you hear me talk about this a lot. It's almost like, you know, putting something together and you got the directions, but you think you know. You hear me talk about this a lot. I'm looking at the picture. I know that's what it's supposed to look like. But when I get done, why do I have parts left over? Doesn't make sense. Basically, bring that into the spiritual realm. You can either wander around the dark trying to figure out on your own how to do something, how to get there, or you can follow the directions and get it right the first time. Directions are important. You don't have to know all the details about how things are supposed to work. You only have to follow the directions that God has given us. Right? What are they? What are those directions? And I close with this. The scripture we started with, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Trust on the Lord. Lean not unto your own understanding. Acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. You know, he's the road sign that's always there. Sometimes we just got blinders on and we're just kind of going this direction, that way, haphazardly here, there, wherever, whatever like that, right? You know? It's about like me sometimes. I'll be going down the road and I need to go there, right? and I'm in a hurry, but the sign says road closed. Now, how many of you have done what I have done before? We just say, well, let's just see. Anybody but me? And we go down that road, and all of a sudden we get down there, a mile or two down the road. Well, yep, that sign was right. Road is closed. And then all of a sudden I'm saying, well, ignorant, the sign told you that the road was closed. Now you got to go all the way back and go around like the sign was pointing you to. I can laugh about that, but I can't laugh about things that pertain to my eternal soul. Because there's all kinds of flashing signs and all kinds of stop signs, and sometimes you can almost see the Lord, and maybe He's got the angels out there and they're all just going like this. Right? But yet we just kind of go on our own way. We get hurry. We're in a hurry in life. And we get ourselves entangled in things in the world, and we find ourselves back trying to figure out where things went wrong. So let me say it again in the translation. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Never rely on what you think you know. Remember the Lord in everything you do, and He will show you the right way. Folks, that is wisdom. That is wisdom. It's like my dad or my mom, I can't remember, because they probably both said it to me many times, a little phrase that you probably heard too. If you don't listen, you're going to feel. If you don't listen, you're going to feel. Well, I don't want to feel the flames of hell. I don't want to feel what lost is going to feel like. So I want to trust in the Lord. I want to rely on Him with all of my heart. How many of you feel that way tonight? You feel that way? Let's stand together right now and just raise our hands and just say, Lord, thank you for your word, the wisdom of your word. Can you do that with us tonight, Lord God? In closing, Lord, we thank you for your word. It truly is a lamp to our feet. It strengthens us. It leads us. It guides us. It helps us along the way. I pray, God, let us diligently seek after you. Amen. Let us rely on you, because you are our strength, you're our salvation, you're our hope, you're our help, amen, in a present time of need. Lord, our world is in trouble. Our country is in trouble, Lord. Help us to keep our eyes fixed on you, knowing that, Lord, if our eyes are not on you, it's going to be on other things, and we're going to falter, we're going to fail, and even possibly fall by the wayside. But God, I pray that you would minister, amen, to us tonight, and help us, Lord Jesus, to lean on you, your strength, amen, what you have asked us to do, to rely on you, not on ourselves, to trust in you, not in ourselves. And you'll help us get through it, Lord, and you'll direct our paths. God, help us to be the light, amen, that you desire for us to be. Amen, as we reach out in this world and we live in this world, amen, let our light so shine that they might see you in us and that they might find their way as well in the truth of your word, in His salvation. So bless us tonight, I pray. Lead us and guide us. Go with us. Help us in Jesus' name. And everybody say, in Jesus' name. God bless you. Amen. Remember Sunday morning, first word, and then following family worship. We had a great time this last week. Amen. Invite your friends and family. Let's come and have a great time. God bless. Shake hands with one another.